experiences. So we are seeing, yes, a lot of innovation in the community, but we're also seeing it from a lot of the larger, more established enterprises.
And how do you think about some of that sort of consumer fintech innovation from the banks? Marcus is part of the example that everyone points to, but other banks like Chase, Barclays, others are also looking to add a lot more consumer fintech features moving forward. How do you think about that relationship with Plaid and also maybe the broader fintech industry as it pertains to banks really sort of upping, I guess, their game in space now?
I think it's incredible. We first and foremost think about financial technology innovation from a consumer's perspective, and adding a consumer more options is undoubtedly better. So instead of having one option to take a loan, you now have tens or hundreds of options to take a loan. Instead of having one option for a checking account, you now have many, many options for a checking account. And the more that these new options are being digitally enabled, digitally distributed, the more availability we'll have to more consumers. I do like that some of the areas that we really touch on are thinking about how to deliver financial services products to those that historically have not had as much access to financial services products. So either those kind of at the edges of the existing financial system or those certain categories that have had kind of fewer options available to them. And with more banks building new things, the distribution is just going to increase. So ultimately, coming back to the consumer perspective, I love that banks are innovating and thinking about building new and better financial service products, and it's only going to drive better outcomes.
Great. So I want to get to some of the specific ideas in the RFS this year. One of the areas where you listed a couple of the ideas were focused on the elderly, so financial tools for the elderly, liquidity for fixed access, for fixed assets. You guys work with a broad segment of different startups, but I'm curious how you might think about that in relation to sort of fintech today. Would you imagine that those financial tools for the elderly segment, for example, might look a lot different in terms of distribution, user interfaces, et cetera, for some of those areas?
Yeah, there's a lot of opportunity to focus on groups that are either traditionally underrepresented in financial services or haven't had the financial services kind of evolve with their needs. The elderly is one particular population, something that we hear a lot from consumers, both giving feedback to the applications that are built on Plaid, but also just more generally in market searching for answers. Navigating the financial system when you are either the executor on a parent's estate or in financial control of a parent's finances for one reason or another, or not in financial control that needs to be, is inherently very difficult. There have been few great products that are built specifically focused for the elderly, and this is an area of the market that we see significant demand yet few solutions. So I think the challenges are unique in this section. Trust is the absolute an absolute imperative here. And as we go forward, I hope that folks will start to build new and better products for this market.
Great. And you also highlighted several infrastructure ideas in the RFS. You hear from a lot of venture capitalists today that seem more focused to be looking for, sort of the next Plaid, right? But maybe to play devil's advocate, what are some of the biggest challenges, why it'll be challenging for infrastructure-focused startups to succeed or scale? I'm curious to hear some of the lessons you guys have learned over the last few years in relation to maybe some of the ideas that we see here on the RFS.
Yeah, infrastructure is a difficult market, and it's something that you have to have really high conviction because testing infrastructure products is very hard to get. So, for example, in the case of Plaid, we spent the better part of 18 months just headed down building products that we believed and had early signals would be really great for the market and would have really strong product market fit. But it's impossible to launch a partial solution. When you're building an infrastructural product, you kind of have to have it work end-to-end. And it takes high conviction then to go through that process of creating the entire thing before you can start to actually scale on the other side. So this concept of a minimum viable product, when it is the core or the foundational elements to your customers, it's impossible to have this minimum viable product, or at least the concept of minimum is actually quite large. So building infrastructural products is really difficult. It's hard to test. But ultimately, they have a really high impact and really deep connection. One of our big beliefs at Plaid is that we want to bring down the barriers to entry financial services and enable many more people to focus on innovating and creating the next generation of great financial tools and products. We certainly think about how we do that as a company, but more importantly, we think about it as to how we do it as an ecosystem. So when we say there are a lot of infrastructural elements that could continue to kind of push consumer financial services forward or financial services generally forward, this is our really earnest attempt to try to help innovators and kind of highlight areas that we hope something will exist that will continue to push the innovation forward across the market.
Interesting. So just you get that perspective of really having that focus. I'm curious, I know that Plaid, for example, first started as you guys thought about building perhaps a consumer-based product, right, or sort of personal finance management or others that came out of that. I'm curious, given what you know today and building the company, do you still see the possibilities for maybe consumer-facing companies or people even just taking that route to actually decide on finding some sort of niche and building out an infrastructure product instead? Or is that much harder to do now knowing what you know about sort of being able to scale a fintech infrastructure company?
I think figuring out infrastructural challenges and which one to build for is hard, and it's almost impossible for an outsider to do. So working within a company, starting a company, or just experiencing pain in the space is probably the best way to identify the infrastructural holes. However, when building an infrastructural company, it really does have to be a truly dedicated effort to go and solve that one specific problem that you see over and over. And so I'd say, in essence, it's really difficult to have a company with dual mission, which is why when early on we identified that there was a hole in the market around kind of linking bank accounts with applications on the web, we pivoted the company entirely and focused solely on building that infrastructure, with the belief and understanding that there was a lot of pent-up demand for innovation in tech, and just a lack of good infrastructure for them. I think as other entrepreneurs were aware of the space, my hope is that if they choose to chase down an infrastructural challenge, that they are fully dedicated to doing so, and use the knowledge that they have of the broader financial services industry to make it happen.
Great. So I'd love to pivot discussion maybe to Plaid now. So for maybe those who are unfamiliar with the company, can you just give a 30-second elevator pitch on what Plaid does?
Absolutely. Plaid builds infrastructure that enables you to interact with your bank account on the web. The core theory behind Plaid is that banking was built for a world that didn't envision the internet, but over time, consumers have demanded new and better, digitally native, mobile-focused financial experiences. Yet there was always an infrastructural gap between our existing financial infrastructure and the tools and services available to developers that were building those applications. Plaid's goal is to bridge that gap. The mission is to enable innovation by delivering access to the financial system. So by delivering our tools and services, our set of APIs, to developers that are creating great new financial services products, and we hope that we can enable quicker innovation, more products out there on the market that are ultimately driving more value to consumers and businesses.
Great. So since you guys have launched Plaid, it's incredible growth. All right.
Today I'm going further.
As well as integration with tons of banks.
Carrying more water.
One of Plaid's earliest customers was Venmo. Can you just maybe walk us through that meeting or that experience?
Yesterday.
And how do you guys sort of figure to get them on board? Is this more happening by chance? Love to hear maybe a little bit, maybe
I think yesterday,
the
trip back, may well.
We were focused on building a consumer financial management application, similar to a new
machine or shut up.
We worked on building a series of these, but over time found that one of our biggest limiting factors as a business was the lack of good infrastructure to connect a bank account to an application.
I was feeling I'm going to get warm.
focused on building these
on this ride.
So in the early phases,
might have to shed. I've got shorts on, so I might shed my pants. Pick them up on the way back. Or I might shed my shirt. I'm not going to leave this jacket. I got this jacket in Iceland. So I'm not going to leave it somewhere and have somebody pick it up. Plus it's bright yellow, nice for biking.
And over time, it took a few months before we were able to release the specific feature set that they were looking for. But when we did, it was amazing to see the shifting consumer behavior, where historically, in order to link a bank account to something on the web, you had to do this thing called the deposit, which means you come to an application, you type in your account number, you type in your routing number, you wait 3 days, then you go check your bank statement, look for the 2 and 4 cent deposit, then go back to the application, type in, oh, I got 2 and 4 cents, and then you can start using it. There's a high latency, multi-day delay along the way of signing up for products. We said, well, can we automate that? Can we make it much quicker, a lot more speed in real time, based on instant bank applications. And when we were able to do that, it was amazing to see just the shifting consumer traffic, the shifting consumer behavior, which then enabled them and many other companies to scale really quickly by using automated bank features.
So Zach, why don't you tell us a little bit about how Plaid got started?
So my co-founder William and I had this theory that there was a way to build a better set of tools to help consumers live kind of more complete and more informed financial lives. Financial stress is the number one stress on consumers in the U.S., and much of the stress is kind of due to a lack of great tools and services. Financial services was built for a world that didn't envision the internet. It was built for a paper-based, branch-based, in-person world. Yet consumers live increasingly digital financial lives. And as my co-founder William and I were thinking about this problem, we started to work on a series of consumer financial applications to help consumers better understand their finances, understand their balances, understand their spending patterns, and manage those over time. This was before we ever hit on this.